Okay. We'll move forward. So anyway, thank you so much. I was very pleased when Alonzo wrote to me and asked me to come and be one of your speakers. It's very exciting for me. I had just been visiting Querétaro and visiting Thalia and visiting her center, and I traveled back to Los Angeles, and I was back one day, and I got an email from Alonzo inviting me here, and I was very excited to have the chance to come back and talk to you. And I'm going to be presenting a little bit of some of our work on graphical data mining. I want to give you a little bit of a backstory about how we arrived at the University of Southern California, because for many years we were at the University of California, Los Angeles, which is right across town. So let me give you a little bit of backstory about that. So in Los Angeles, there are two main universities. There's the University of California, Los Angeles. You might know this as UCLA. They are called the Bruins, so they have a bear as their mascot, and this is their mascot. And then across town, they have the University of Southern California, and we have this Trojan warrior guy as our mascot. And so if you look at a map of Los Angeles, University of California, Los Angeles, UCLA is located in the Westwood district of Los Angeles, and USC, University of Southern California, has two campuses, one that's kind of in downtown, and another which is their health sciences campus, which is only about 15 minutes car ride away. And they're fierce rivals, these two schools. They hate each other. They really hate each other. And so when they play American football against one another, this is a huge, big rivalry. It's called the game in Los Angeles, and they get together and they play football. And the winner of that game every year gets to take home this bell, which is on a little, it's probably about that's the size of a big wagon. And they get to paint it their school color. So when this picture was taken, UCLA must have won. And then every year, collectively, over all the sports that they play, it's a competitive kind of collective competition called the gauntlet. And if UCLA comes out as the winner of more matches than USC does, then they win the gauntlet and vice versa. And they've even created this trophy that trades hands, and then they stitch the name of the winning school on there, and it's this glove like a coat of armor. And so they trade places. And whenever there's any sort of a gauntlet win, it's big news. It's in all the newspapers. So they don't like each other very much on the football field, in sports, but also academically. They hate to see each other upstaged. And so we were at UCLA for a number of years, and a couple of years ago, in 2013, these articles came out in our Los Angeles Times newspaper saying that USC had stolen these kind of top research group from UCLA, and then we were moving across town, and they were giving us piles and piles of money to come and do our research at USC. And this was very interesting and controversial, it was kind of funny because in one of the newspapers that they had, they printed this comic, which is, you can kind of tell that, so the UCLA is represented by this little river which is running dry and has these little puny little fish in it, and these are the Bruins who have neuroscience and researchers on them, and they're being attracted by this Trojan hugging these big fish with indicative of lots of flexibility, facilities, and money, which is very important. So we have moved across town, and earlier this year, we were renamed the Mark and Mary Stevens Neuroimaging and Informatics Institute. This is the building, which is under construction for us right now, and we expect to be able to move into it in about April or May of next year. This will be our imaging facility right here, where we will have a not only state-of-the-art 3T Siemens Prisma scanner, but also a 7T Siemens magnetome. We're very excited about that. It's really going to be able to kind of drive some of our research. This will be the only 7 Tesla scanner in Los Angeles, which is pretty cool. So we're excited about that. And so that's kind of a little bit of backstory about how we got to the University of Southern California, and how I got there too. So this is a lot, because this is some a sample of some of the types of research that I do and that my team does and that we do collectively through this institute. And we do a lot of different kind of work. So a lot of it is patient-oriented, so we do a lot of work with traumatic brain injury. Traumatic brain injury is a very interesting thing computationally and mathematically, because they're not normal anymore. When you take a nice, healthy, plump, juicy 22-year-old brain and you damage it, all of your algorithms with FSL, with FreeSurfer, many of you probably are familiar with these software packages, they don't really work, or you can't trust them to work. And so you need to be thinking very carefully about how you deal with traumatic brain injury. We do a lot of stuff with connectivity and diffusion tensor imaging. I know that's very a popular thing in one of Alonso's areas. And we've even done some stuff with trying to stitch together CT data with MRI data and diffusion tensor data to model famous injuries like the famous injury of Mr. Phineas Gage. Does everybody know who Phineas Gage is? Yes? No? But anyway, he was in 1848, he was working on a railroad to help to flatten the railroad track, and he was in the act of packing some explosives into a hole using an iron rod, and he had forgotten to put the sand into the hole, and he dropped the iron rod into the rock, and it sparked and caused the black powder to explode, and it drove this iron rod up underneath his cheekbone, behind his eyeball, through his brain, and out through the top of his head. And it's one of the most famous neurological injuries, because he lived for 11 years after this. And this is kind of a picture of this of the rod traveling through his face and his head, cutting through his white matter and his gray matter. So anyway, we've done a lot of different stuff. And all of this stuff is very computationally challenging. These are big data problems. And this means that students like you really need to be thinking about how you're going to be dealing with the massive quantities of data that we're now able to collect with neuroimaging. I like to tell the story of when I was just about your age, I worked in a laboratory where my lab supervisor had asked me, can you go buy the hard disk that we're going to use to put all of our data on, to store all of our vast quantities of neuroimaging data? And I went out and I went shopping, and I think I spent about, I don't know, it was a large amount of money at that time, and I bought this hard disk, and it was the biggest hard disk that we could find, and it was 4 gigabytes. And I thought, this is infinity. I will never fill this up. This is massive. And you know, now you can eat 4 gigabytes for breakfast. It's nothing, right? And we're some of our computing facilities that we have at our institute, we're storing about 6 petabytes worth of storage, and in a few years, that'll be considered cute and small and not very interesting. And so we have to come up with these kind of, we focused on neuroscience, but that isn't entirely the excuse me, the picture either. It's neuroimaging, it's genetics, it's proteomics, and focusing on what big computing one needs to have in place to be able to do modern day 21st century large scale science. And so it is working very closely with mathematicians, with computer scientists, with engineers to write algorithms which deal with
There we go.
Okay. It's back. To work with a number of different people with who are writing the algorithms, who are turning it into code for processing these data. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about this a little bit later, about this Lonnie pipeline software that we've developed, which I think you may be interested in, and leveraging large-scale computing. This is a picture of what our computing facility looks like, and will look like even more so in the future, where we've got even little very pretty lights in here. It's very nice. But being able to use this code using workflow technologies on very large-scale hardware to produce beautiful brain maps that look like this. So neuroimaging really is a big data problem. And a few years ago, we were involved with a thing called the Human Connectome Project. This is a large-scale project funded by the United States National Institutes of Health, with the idea of collecting the best diffusion tensor imaging that could ever be collected. And our colleagues at the Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston developed a scanner working very closely with the Siemens company. This is the Ferrari of 3T imaging systems. And it collects some of the most beautiful diffusion data you've ever seen. A lot of that data is freely available for anybody, including yourselves, to be able to get access to look at, and it's really, truly beautiful. And as we continue to work with people who make scanners, to people who are developing the algorithms and whatnot, you start to see this emergence of this cycle of data multiplication, and you can understand why data continues to get larger. So usually, there's some sort of advance in the neuroimaging technology. This MRI physicists earn their pay by turning the screws, by making the scanners work faster to get more data per unit time at better resolution. That's what they do. And then this gives you basically the ability to collect more data. This enhances your neuroscience questions that you can ask, and you can scan more subjects per day, per month, per year, and this means you can engage in multi-site trials, so you can partner with multiple institutions to be able to collect vast quantities of data on these scanners. But then you have a need for computation for data storage, which helps to promote a desire to collect still more data and more ask more questions, which results in advances in neuroimaging technology. And as a result, all of this data gets really big, really big. And so you can kind of understand why that might be the case. A number of years ago, when I was a faculty member at Dartmouth College, we kind of saw this coming, I guess, a little bit. We were very prescient in seeing where the field was going, and we realized that a lot of the large data sets that were being collected in functional neuroimaging studies were not being stored, shared, or available outside of the small group of authors who worked on that particular paper. And this was a real shame, because there might be students like you who, if you could get your hands on that data, you could reproduce the findings that were presented in the published article, that you could apply your own algorithms to do image registration, image segmentation, signal processing, statistics, you name it, or you could gather that data and pull it with a bunch of other data sets to do an even bigger mega analysis of all of that data. And so we undertook this project called the fMRI Data Center, which was an attempt to gather the data from the peer-reviewed publications, gather it all up, package it up, and then be able to send that data out to anywhere in the world. We started this with the best of intentions, and an interesting thing happened. So I think now we probably understand that, boy, that sounds like a really good idea. I'd like to be able to do that. But what happened was, started writing articles in the literature very critical of our intentions. And so people said, oh, this whole idea of sharing data gives these brain mappers a real headache. They don't know how to deal with it. People thought there's a real debate over whether or not we should be sharing data at all. Perhaps it's too early. Perhaps we don't understand the bold effect, and we need to wait until we figured that out. Or people said, hey, wait, these are my scans. I did a lot of work to collect these scans, and I paid a lot of money. I don't want to give these away. Why would I do that? And other main organizations, like the Organization for Human Brain Mapping, came out with policy pieces about when one should share data, how it should be done, et cetera. And even colleagues of mine, like Arthur Toga, who's our institute director, had chimed in on this, saying that there were neuroimaging databases which were good, which were bad, and were ugly, and it wasn't too hard to figure out which one Dr. Toga thought we might be. Thought we were probably pretty ugly. We persevered with this, we did it anyway, and in the end we were able to get the complete data sets from over 120 peer-reviewed publications. This is thousands of subjects, millions of fMRI time points across both fMRI, structural, DTI, all different patient groups from a number of different cognitive paradigms, and send it to thousands of researchers around the world. It ended up not being able to be sustainable because the funding ran out, but as a point of principle, we thought it was an excellent demonstration, an excellent experiment in kind of the social engineering behind data sharing and big data.
We thought it was pretty cool.
So now, of course, there are big data resources all over the place. It is not hard to find a number of different databases or databasing systems or repositories that allow you to share your data, to get data, to download it, and to use it for algorithm development, for thinking about math and whatnot. There's a database called COINS, one called OpenFMRI, XMAT, maybe you've heard of some of these. And it's interesting because the U.S. government now requires, if you're doing autism neuroimaging research, you are required to share your data with an archive called the National Database for Autism Research. Similarly, if you're doing traumatic brain injury, you're expected to share your data with a thing called the Federal Interagency Traumatic Brain Injury Research System, called FITBR. And so if you're funded to do autism, to do TBI, increasingly other forms of mental health, you're doing neuroimaging in those domains, you're expected to share your data with these resources. Very interesting. And so it's just organically now coming around that it's now possible to share data and to use it as well. So here's some examples of just some of the types of databases that we have at our institute in Los Angeles. These are within our own center. We have one giant database, but it's kind of partitioned into a number of different sub-databases. And we have them, they're usually kind of disease-focused, so we have one that's on called the Parkinson's Progressive Markers Initiative. It's neuroimaging related to Parkinson's disease, so many of you probably know about Parkinson's disease. People like Michael J. Fox, people like Muhammad Ali, athletes and whatnot have this, and so they're a major player in that. The Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging Initiative, so this is for people with Alzheimer's disease or mild cognitive impairment, and I'll come back to some of that in a moment. The Human Connectome Project, a thing called the Burn Project, Track HD, which is for Huntington's disease, and a thing called Enigma, which is a kind of large-scale data sharing resource that we also supervise. Collectively, all of these are all part of this big ecosystem of data. And this is this thing we care and we kind of help to feed and keep growing because it's such an amazing ability to gather all this data. Again, we're talking petabytes worth of storage that we have to dedicate to this. So it becomes a very big data problem. And I would like to say that Latin America as well, and this is the second time I've been to Mexico this year. I was in Brazil earlier. I've been to Havana several times, and each time I've been to a place in Latin America, I've been very impressed by the amount of research which is going on in Sao Paulo. They have a 7 Tesla system like the one that we're about to get, and we went to the inaugural opening of the Cuban Neuroscience Center, where many of you know Pedro Vadlos Sosa. He is a good friend to many of us. I was honored as a guy from the U.S. to be able to go to Havana to take part in that inaugural to see their scanner, which you can still see is kind of in bubble wrap here. Pedro has spearheaded this notion of a Latin American brain mapping network. This is something which, if you don't know about, you should investigate. I think it's very exciting with the idea of folks from across Latin America being able to partner, share data, share ideas, share resources, and every once in a while they get together and take a group photo. this is a very exciting thing, and as I mentioned, even Cuba, with all of we know about Cuba, but also how wonderful it is with some of the recent Cuban Neuroscience Center activities. I was involved in writing this article, which came out in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, really encouraging science as the way between the U.S. and Cuba can begin its interactions, and as the relationship there warms up, and we're very excited about that. I think there's huge opportunity for collaboration with colleagues in Cuba. We're excited about that. So one of the things I wanted to kind of mention is, historically, whenever we've had data in neuroimaging, the first thing we want to think about is, how do we average it all together? How do we create the average brain? And It's kind of interesting, oops, excuse me, because we have a number of different brain atlases. We're crazy with brain atlases. We have them in book form. Here's just a collection of all of them as books. And obviously creating things like the M&I atlas that many of you use and register your data to as a pre-processing step is kind of a critical step in the whole thing. And in averaging brains, you know, very often we're taking a brain which looks like this, another brain which looks like this, and taking these multitude of brains and gathering them all up. Notice how individually they vary. They vary in their gyro and their sulcal architecture, in the size and shape of the various lobes and whatnot. And somehow, through the magic of mathematics, we go and we squish it all together until we create something that looks like this, bolted into some sort of a framework. This started to bother me a little bit. This started to seem kind of like this pro forma thing that we always did. You take your data and you just pull it together and you make an average. And I kind of got to wonder about that because it belies the variability that exists between all of brains. Everybody in this room, your brain is a different shape, different kind of size, has different, it's like a fingerprint, and your brain is different than the person you're sitting next to. And somehow all this averaging washes all that out. I kind of got a little frustrated by that, and I thought, well, I wonder if there's another way. And I want to try to describe for you now how at least one way I kind of thought up, which I think might be kind of interesting, and it won't have too much math in it. There won't be any equations, but I can assure you there is some. So typically, you want to kind of get your sense around what is this notion of a brain atlas. So let's just stick with that for a second. So usually, it's some sort of a book or some sort of frame of reference that you're talking about. But in brain imaging, we're always talking about the average brain. But we can actually extend this idea of an atlas because I was driving around with Alonso last night, here in Guanajuato, your atlas is very interesting because there's a lot of underground stuff that you don't see, right? But it's part of the atlas that is this particular town. And so our notion of what an average is kind of interesting because what goes into the creation of that atlas actually is very important. So this notion of just taking all your data and just pooling it together, I got very concerned about. And you can ask yourself, can't we just take all these data and pool them together? Isn't that just fine? Can't we do that? Well, you can do that. But if you start to look at meta-analyses, for example, and do a little data mining, the thing that you find is that you can sort of do that, and it's more complicated than you might think. This is a very simplistic kind of example, but I want to point out two instances where I looked at this in some detail, where this was the very first paper I ever got published, ever, in 1991. And a few years later, about 20 years later, I went with a couple of students, and we went to kind of retell this to see what had happened. Let me explain what we did. Back when I was where you guys are now, one of the key theories in the notion of understanding schizophrenia was ventricular size, so the size of the lateral cerebral ventricles. And so study after study were done that were sort of like this. They would have a normal control subject, and in the space, the slice where the ventricles appeared the largest, they would go and they would draw the outline of those ventricles and then calculate the area of those ventricles. And then they would take the same in the same slice, calculate the area of that particular slice. And if you then divided the area of the ventricles by the area of the brain in that slice and multiply by 100, you get out a percentage, right? And so they called it the ventricular brain ratio, which was a percentage of ventricle taken up in that slice relative to the brain. Well, in patients with schizophrenia who have enlarged ventricles, you can kind of see that the ventricular brain ratio would probably be quite a bit larger in schizophrenics than in controls. Tons of studies that came out doing this. So I went and I looked at all these different studies, and I looked at the reported values of the control subject's ventricular brain ratio and the schizophrenic patient ventricular brain ratio, and just plotted them out over the years of the study. And an interesting kind of thing emerged. I noticed very strangely that the regression line for the schizophrenic ventricular brain ratio was getting smaller, whereas the regression line for the control subjects was getting larger. Whoa, what is that all about, right? Wait a minute, how can these control subjects, how can they're getting bigger? What's that mean, right? Why is the schizophrenics getting smaller over time? This was very puzzling, right? So in our paper, we thought, well, probably what's happening is an interesting thing. The control conditions of these studies are getting better. In the early studies, in order to find control subjects, the researchers would go and they would root through the neurological files and find CT scans of people who had had headaches or whatever, but were otherwise deemed normal. And they would take those CT scans, this was back when they were on film, and they would hold them up to the light and they'd go, oh my God, look at the size of those ventricles, that person can't be normal, and they would take them out of consideration. So they were artificially culling off the upper tail of that very skewed distribution, inflating the size of the difference between the controls and the schizophrenics. That seemed to be what was going on. And the schizophrenics, people were just much more strict over time about what constituted a schizophrenic. Early on, it was, you know, have you ever had a hallucination ever? And that was considered good enough. After a while, it was much more strict against DSM-3, DSM-4 criteria to be able to define schizophrenia. It was so that difference would get smaller. So anyway, you can see the regression lines were converging. Well, I went in, again, in 2011, we looked at this, and what was kind of interesting is that apparently our study must have had some kind of effect, because the sooner after these studies, actually for the control subjects, it kind of changed direction. They started to get smaller again, but the schizophrenics continued on their downward trend. Another thing which was kind of interesting about this is when we looked at the number of authors on the paper, against the size of the difference between the schizophrenics and controls, the size of that difference got statistically more significantly less the more co-authors the article had. This is another what's that mean kind of thing. And what we reckon is that when you have, say, two authors, there's this real charge to go and publish your result. Hey, we got a significant result. Let's go publish. Whereas if you have 12 or 14 authors, you know, there's a lot more people to please and a lot more rigor going on. So there's an interesting sociological effect. But what this kind of suggests is that pulling things together, both with, you know, across populations or across time or across scanners or across a number of different, any of these factors to create some sort of an average might actually not be a very smart thing to do in every case. It's always been very useful, but it may not always be smart. Now, typically, data goes through a workflow of processing, and you're probably all familiar with this, where the data that comes off the scanner will very likely go through a series of steps before it produces anything that you would feel comfortable giving a poster on, talking about in a research article, or what have you. And this is just an exemplar of a cartoon of a workflow, where you'd have your raw fMRI data, for example, and it would go through a slice timing adjustment, image space, spatial adjustment, co-registration with a structural image, spatial normalization, maybe you have some study metadata and a design matrix, et cetera, et cetera. It all comes together in the end, and in the end, you get some sort of a map, graphical overlay, and maybe a table of statistical results. This is a very lossy process. Obviously, by the time you get down to this table, it's something you could put into an email. You started with gigabytes worth of data, and you boiled it all down to this statistical table. One of the things which is kind of interesting about that is that, it belies this the variance in this data, and I'll get to that in a second. We've actually taken this idea, and we kind of tried to flesh this out. I'm going to go into a lot more detail on this when I talk about this during my next talk, about this notion of what's called Monte pipeline. And it's this thing that we've developed now. It's in its 6.2 revision. We're very excited about it, and I've got some materials that I think Alonzo has and can make available to you, and I'll talk about it more soon. But the idea is to have this workflow environment, which allows you to create, graphically create diagrams like this, to encode your processing steps so that you can feed all of the big data that you're collecting through this, and it will take advantage of a cluster computer that you have and then run all the data really fast. And so we use this all the time, and it has a number of different advantages, and I'll go into all that soon, but you can make simple workflows, and you can, with a bunch of other, see, this is, the slide's already out of date, because it's ongoing development, but it has a number of different features which allow you to go create very complex workflows, and if you get really crazy, you can make complete end-to-end processing steps. But anyway, I'll explain that on my talk here in an hour or so. But one of the things that's, another thing that we've been very interested in is visualizing white matter. Visualization is kind of key in all this. you can go and do, you know, no offense, but you can do all the math you like, but we're neuroimagers, at least I am, and we're very visual creatures. We like to look at the result of the data. And so things that look like this, this is very pretty. Like, look at the fornix in this. Beautiful fornix. You want to be able to see that. So visualization of white matter has been something that I've taken a personal interest in, because it's also kind of a big data idea. But we've also tried to twist it a little bit. I'll try and show you kind of some of the thing that we did with that. There's a number of different approaches to trying visualizing the network structure, the kind of connectedness of the brain using diffusion imaging and other tools. Here's just, this came from a review that was done a couple of years ago, looking at all the different kind of approaches that people use. And we tried to do our own little twist on this. And you'll see this every once in a while. If many of you go to the Organization for Human Brain Mapping meeting, which is a very exciting meeting. If you haven't gone to that, it's kind of the flagship meeting for brain mapping. You'll see this. But here's the approach that we took, and you'll start to see the result of this approach appearing on multiple posters at meetings like this. So you have your automatic segmentation that you get, say, with FreeSurfer. You co-register that with your DTI. You have your parcellation. You use it to go and calculate how many fibers travel from each patch, each parcel here in your parcel to brain. You create a connectivity matrix. And then we developed a methodology to turn them into what we call a connectogram. And this is an abstracted notion of the connectedness taken out of the brain space, but put into kind of a 2D circular framework, which we've actually grown quite fond of. Let me kind of show you a little bit about how to interpret these things. So here's a connectogram, which doesn't look as nice on this projector as it does on my computer. But each one of the, so each hemisphere of this circular annulus here is the hemisphere of the brain. So left side of the circle here is the left hemisphere, right side is the right hemisphere. And each of these little kind of chunks, segments, represents a lobe of the brain as parcelated by the FreeSurfer Atlas. And each one of these little segments of it represents one little segment, one little piece of cortical parcellation within that lobe. So we have the frontal lobe, the insular, limbic, temporal, parietal, occipital, and we stuck all of the stuff down in the brainstem, basal ganglia, and whatnot down here, the 6 o'clock position on this clock. And so another thing is, if you take one of these little segments and look at it, you'll see that you've got each one of these little brain segments. There's kind of a little code for what that part of the brain is. It's colorized so that you can map it and see the visual of where you are in the on the brain space with where you are in this space. So each little segment has a different color map. And then each one of these little heat maps represents a different attribute of that particular chunk of neural real estate's kind of aspects. So this would be gray matter volume, for example, the area of that particular parcellation, its mean cortical thickness, curvature. You can do all sorts of geometric statistics such as curvature, as well as the degree of connectivity, how many fibers start or stop in that particular region. And then we have all these little lines. These little lines are the integrated number of fibers, a relative density of fibers, which come into or depart from that particular region and connect with another region. We've also colorized them based on fractional anisotropy. So things that are red are going to be highly fractionally anisotropic. Things that are green are going to be kind of in the middle. And things which are blue are going to be at the relatively low end of fractional anisotropy, integrated over all the fibers which transit that particular connection. And so with this in one kind of snapshot, you can see all of this information about brain morphometry and brain connectivity. And we've used this quite liberally across a number of different studies. Especially looking at traumatic brain injury and some of the big data problems that we have there. Here's an average taken over about 112 individuals, and they get to be looking really pretty. And they're really kind of a cool thing to look at, and again, we have started to look at this. Because the visual impact of this is so important. Just saying that, you know, oh, this connection has a fractional anisotropy of 0.6, well, that's nice, but what's that mean in the overall context of how the brain is connected? We wanted a way to do that, and this is one of the ways we've begun to think about doing that. And I mentioned that case of Mr. Gage. So Mr. Gage, you'll see a little movie here. You'll have to, I think you'll agree with me, that this looks like it really, really hurt.
This was painful. And the guy survived for 11 years after this injury. And this was, there was a lot of math that went into just generating this. And once we had that, we were able to take the data from a big cohort of subjects that were similar in age. They were men, similar in age, and similar in ethnicity to Mr. Gage. And we pulled them all into this analysis, and then we were able to model, this is sort of the negative space, indicating which were the fibers that were transected by the passage of this iron rod through his head. So this ended up being very popular. This was in a lot of the on the news. It was pretty cool. So this is how we've employed this, and it's visually very impactful to be able to look at not only a picture of Mr. Gage's head, but also an assessment of how much damage was done by this famous injury. So here's kind of some examples of looking at variability across people. So just looking across individuals, there's enormous variability in their connectivity. And we've looked at these in patient data all over the place. So this got me thinking about big data, about visualization, about workflows, about all this stuff. And I wanted to kind of come up with a way to take it all and synthesize it in a way that was kind of cool, kind of sexy in a way. And so we invented this thing that we kind of likened to be able to dynamically visualize the variance in all of these data. So we developed this thing, we call it Invision, which is informatics visualization for neuroimaging, and it's kind of a portmanteau of those words. And we've had a couple of publications on this, and I'll explain a little bit more about this picture in a second. But we have a website, which is invision.lani.usc.edu, and we really thought that this individual variability, this all of this sea of variability, this wasn't a problem that needed to be regressed out or averaged out. This was actually an opportunity for us to be able to look at all this. And so here's our attempt to kind of do this. What we did is we drew from what's called our image and data archive. This is the database that we have. It's kind of the database that controls all the databases that I showed you before. And so it's a really rich database. You can go in here and you can do searches for things. You can go and get that data. And it has a number of attributes which are kind of you would expect to have in a big data database. We took the data from what's called the Alzheimer's disease neuroimaging initiative data set, and it's about 900 or so subjects that have been scanned longitudinally, and about it's not quite a third and a third and a third, but it breaks down to patients with diagnosed Alzheimer's disease, patients with mild cognitive impairment, so they're not quite fully diagnosed as Alzheimer's disease, and healthy control subjects, older healthy control subjects. And these are all fairly old participants in this study. It's an ongoing study. It's now in its kind of third iteration. It's a very interesting data set to work with. And it's probably one of the prime examples of one of the benefits of shared data in neuroimaging. And I encourage you guys to check it out. All the data is free to be able to play with. And if you're doing any clever algorithm development, there's been hundreds, literally hundreds of publications on using this data set for algorithm development, and you might want to look into it as well. So we took the T1 anatomical data from the people's first visit to the ADNI cohort study, and we took their T1 anatomical data and we parcelated it using FreeSurfer, and we were able to go and create surface meshes of all of those brains. And then from each of the parcelations, we were able to create feature vectors, which included cortical thickness, area, curvature, a number of other different things. And we tried to come up with about feature vectors, which were about, say, 12 or so parameters in length, and create one of those feature vectors for each one of the parcellations in each person's brain. And then systematically, here's a sample of some of them. I think there's more than just this, but for those of you mathematicians in the audience, you'll probably be familiar with things like shape index, curvature principle, max principle, min principle, mean curvature, Gaussian curvature, area, volume, and a number of others, and create these feature vectors. And then by going through and using a mutual information criteria, we were able to go and compare these feature vectors across each region across people and integrated across people to create basically a subject-by-subject distance matrix where it's an information-based distance, right? So it's measured in bits. And then we actually took a very simple approach, but one could take any number of other approaches for how do you decompose that distance matrix into subspaces that carry information. We chose very simplistically multidimensional scaling, one because it was easy, and also it was kind of hypothesis-free. But anybody who's doing machine learning or you're doing support vector machines or something where you'd like to inform your analysis, that is certainly possible too. Any sort of a decomposition which will break things down into a like an eigenvalue, eigenvector structure, that will work too. So we chose multidimensional scaling, and we were able to go break things down and come up with it. It looked like there were about three dimensions in these data that kind of described everything. And if you go and you plot these data against the, here's an example of the subject-by-subject distance matrix, just from like MATLAB. But if you go and plot this out, you get something which looks like this. Now, it's kind of interesting because you have your kind of, this is actually your the ADME distribution, but it's also been coupled with another distribution of younger, relatively healthy subjects. So you can kind of see that there's an age dimension here as well. But if you begin to look at this, looking at dot plots, wasn't very exciting. And I kind of, you're all familiar with Google Earth, right? Remember the Google Earth moment, the first time you kind of saw Google Earth? I always think about this, right? You say, what's this Google Earth about? And you go and you open it up, and the planet goes, you go, oh, that's kind of interesting. And you take your mouse and you kind of click on it, and you fly around and you land someplace. And you're like, oh, wow, and you keep zooming in. And really, after about 2 minutes, if you knew how to use a mouse, you knew everything you needed to know about how to interact with Google Earth. Microsoft created a product called the Microsoft Worldwide Telescope, which takes all this astronomical data, all these Hubble Space Telescope images of the cosmos, and does something similar. So instead of looking at the planet, you're looking out towards the heavens. And you can zoom around, and you can zoom in on a star, and you can click on that star and get information. I was like, wow, this is really cool. I want to do this for brain. I want to do this for the brain. Wouldn't this be cool? So we developed something which I think you guys might get a kick out of. So we created this thing that allows you to look, this shrunk, I don't know why. But it allows, basically it's an interface which allows you to look at any of these brain surfaces one at a time. This little circle that's around it will become clear in a second. But it turns out that there's dozens of programs which do this. You can do this, you probably do this every day. You can do this in MATLAB. But one of the things which was kind of interesting is we wanted to make it informative. So if you were to right-click on that brain, that you would get information. So you might be able to bring up a thumbnail of the, this is not just the surface, but this is the MRI data that went into the creation of that surface. So you'd be able to click on it and get that view. Perhaps you'd be able to click on it and get all the metadata associated with that particular subject. So this is coming from the ADME sample. This is a patient. They have mild cognitive impairment. You know their APOE genetic status. You know a number of phenomic attributes to them, the neuropsych scores and whatnot. And we thought, well, this is really cool, but what else can we do? So we started to look at this, here's just a zoom-in version of that metadata. So you have this little window which you can kind of get metadata about. But one of the things which is cool about this is if you take this program and zoom out a little bit, so you're able to represent that the result of that multidimensional scaling by taking the brain surfaces of every subject and placing them at the coordinate that you had extracted from your multivariate decomposition of that distance matrix. And so this is kind of each one of these little brains, it's not the same brain copied multiple times, it's unique to that particular individual. Each of the surfaces themselves are color-coded with respect to the thickness of the cortex at that vertex in that surface. Another thing we did is we wrapped little circles around them, or little bubbles, that were color-coded to indicate which subjects were healthy normal controls, which were mild cognitive impaired people, and which were those with full-on Alzheimer's disease. And this is a very dynamic thing. You can zoom out a little bit more just using your mouse, and you can really get an appreciation for the distribution of these data with respect to each other. So there's no averaging, really, that went on here. We just let each brain kind of speak for itself, and relative to each other, how does the distribution fall out? And then built a system for you to be able to go and surf that particular distribution. So you can zoom out a little bit more, and you can start to see that there's kind of a clear kind of division going on here amongst these subjects. And you can even zoom out so it's almost like it's a galaxy that you've zoomed out far, far away. Kind of interesting. But so now you're looking at 900 brain surfaces all at once, and you're able to do this all using your mouse. You can zoom back in a little bit, and if you look really closely, you can kind of see that there's a natural dividing line between through the middle of this distribution. So if you go and look at this, you've got a dividing line about here, where on this side, you have a preponderance of green circles. Those are the healthy subjects, right? Those are the ones who are they're older, but they're otherwise healthy. Those are these guys. And on this side, you have a preponderance of red circles. Those are the people who have Alzheimer's disease. They have very thin cortices, and if you go and look at those guys, they're living over here. What's interesting about the mild cognitive impairment subjects is that they're all over the place. They trans kind of, they're overlapping both of these guys. So you have people who have mild cognitive impairment who have otherwise very thick cortices. You have people with mild cognitive impairment who they're not Alzheimer's disease patients, but they have very thin cortices. And how people transition, or if they transition from mild cognitive impairment to Alzheimer's disease, may be part of understanding that process is by just surfing the data and letting it speak for itself and seeing if there's some ways for you to identify that dynamically, interactively, and visually. So here's kind of a kind of how this thing works in actuality. You'll notice that we added some very decorative sky boxes here, so it looks like you're flying around in the atmosphere of Saturn, for example, and you can go and spin one brain around and interact with it just using your mouse. Another thing which is kind of in zoom in on it and wrap a bubble around it, depending on what kind of a patient it is, depending upon its metadata. And this has, for me, some of that Google Earth, some of that worldwide telescope sort of interactivity. This one, hopefully that one will start soon. Here, this one shows you kind of how you can zoom in multiple brains simultaneously. So you're really able to look at a multitude of different brains as a collective. And it's interesting, because of the way things cluster here, they came out of our multidimensional scaling, right? You know this, multidimensional scaling is distance preserving, right? And the attribute here is that brains which lie close to each other in this space are the most similar to each other. Those which are the most dissimilar are gonna lie far apart. So it naturally comes out as a mathematical result, and now we're just providing a way for people to view it. It's very cool, we sit students down in front of this. I sat at the time, my 12-year-old daughter down in front of this, and again, within about 2 minutes, she was able to figure out all she needed to do was surf a whole bunch of brain data, about 900 cases worth of brain data. Pretty cool. So this has kind of become a really interesting workhorse for us, to be able to play with data, to surf it through it, to render it in clever ways. It's become kind of a data mining tool. So graphically, we can identify groups of subjects, and we can then compare and contrast them using kind of data exploration techniques, all those kind of classic John Tukey kind of approaches, for just visualizing data, letting the data tell us about itself, in contrast to always forcing a hypothesis and doing a t-test or doing a regression. Let's just explore the data a little bit and understand what that big data has in store and inform what those more sophisticated, more kind of heavy-hitting inferential statistical analyses might involve. So just to kind of wrap all this up, because I've covered a lot of ground here. Big data for our particular form of biomedicine, neuroimaging, genetics, proteomics, it's just going to get bigger. We just don't collect less data. We collect more data all the time. And this is where neuroimaging is going to be at the forefront of this. It's a visual, graphical thing that we collect. Data is laid out in space and time. It's very challenging to deal with, and we're going to need a number of different digital resources to be able to encapsulate this, especially if we want to share it as widely as possible. These things vary. The databases vary a lot, and the amounts of data that they contain, they vary a lot as well. And hopefully those will all get better and be more helpful. NDAR, for example, that National Database of Autism Research, it's having some growing pains because of how it's been structured. I'm pretty sure it's going to get better, but there's a lot of variability in the quality of those data sets that is something to deal with. And also, any of these that are funded by because government money, how governments are, they change their minds, or they decide, okay, we've done enough of that, we're going to go and do this now, and they're going to cut you off. So these things may be subject to the whims of the government, but all of these things can serve as a model for how we can gather data, share it, make it available, and folks like you can develop algorithms and whatnot to process that data in clever ways. I just want to make a little plug for a couple of projects that we do also at our center. We're part of a thing through the U.S. government called the Big Data to Knowledge Program, which is kind of the acronym for that is BD2K. And the idea is to basically develop the methodologies for how you deal with this, how you interact with, how do you manage, how do you store, how do you manipulate all of this big data. And so this is a very exciting project that we actually have not one, not two, but three grants associated with. So there's a lot of money involved, and at least in the U.S., I'm sure, throughout Latin America as well, people are recognizing that we're not collecting less data, we're just collecting more, and we need to prepare ourselves accordingly. Because as we move to a multi-omic neuroscience where data is being collected at all manner of spatial and temporal scales, we're going to need clever mathematics, we're going to need clever computer science techniques. How do you move this data from here to there when it's petabytes in size? All of those things are going to become increasingly important, so you guys are getting involved in this field at exactly the right time. So pat yourselves on the back, because this is going to be the future of this stuff as we move forward. And how we interact with this data and visualize it is going to be truly essential to how we understand it, how we conceptualize it in our heads. Atlasing should be more than just averaging. Variance is a key kind of a thing, and how you visualize that is kind of absolutely critical, because that averaging doesn't tell you the whole story. And things like this thing I presented to you, it's just one idea. This is probably, it's probably even wrong, but it's one attempt to be able to visualize that data and help to serve as a prelude to doing a more sophisticated computational analysis. And so there's further need for people with bright ideas, for people who have the energy and the wherewithal to develop these sort of techniques. And I hope that those people are people in this room, because it's a very exciting time to be involved in big data neuroscience and visualizing it and mining it and analyzing it using methods that you guys are developing. So once again, muchas gracias for having me. I'm very excited to be here. I hope to have a chance to chat with all of you, and you'll hear more about Ronnie Pipeline in whenever it is, half an hour. And so you'll see me again. But once again, thank you very much.